Medicine in the News on BCTV is supported by Tower Health.
Good evening. Welcome to another edition of Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh. With healthcare, there are so many choices with medications, types of physicians, and therapies to see. It can get overwhelming. So tonight, I'm very pleased to have some guests to talk about something called osteopathy, which hopefully most viewers know, or at least most people may have heard of, but not everyone understands exactly what it is and what it can be used for. So we're going to see, for example, how it can be used for many common musculoskeletal problems, but all medical problems as well. So I'm really pleased to have tonight Dr. Aimee Luo, who is the director of the Osteopathic Family Medicine Residency Program at Reading Hospital of Tower Health System, Dr. Hugh Prentice, and Dr. Kelly Garrahy, who are some of our resident physicians there. So again, guys, thank you for coming out tonight and helping us out and learn. And as I told you guys ahead of time, I'm excited to learn more about osteopathy because over the years I've tried to learn one or two things and I just can't catch on. So I'm so glad you guys have gone to school for that. So along those lines, start off, Dr. Luo, what is osteopathy?
So osteopathy actually encompasses a lot of different things. So first and foremost, it's a mindset of, you know, how we view the body, how we try to help each other's bodies heal. So it's definitely a philosophy. We actually in school learn about the different tenets of that philosophy, about how the body is a unit. So if one area of the body is affected, other aspects of the body will be affected as well. But osteopathy also encompasses OMM, which is part of what we're going to talk about today, which is a series of techniques that we as osteopathic physicians have in our tool belt. So when a patient comes in and they have really kind of any ailment under the sun, we can treat them with a manual type therapy that will hopefully get them back to feeling better, help their body function the way it was supposed to.
So it sounds a lot like the philosophy you learn in your training is similar to allopathic MD medicine, but really a much more holistic approach is what it sounds like. Did you guys, during your schooling, is that something that you noticed in the training?
Yeah, I think what we do, we learn all the same, you know, biochemical pathways that all the allopathic physicians would also learn as well. But we do have, like Dr. Luo said, this other piece in our tool belt, which we're able to kind of bring out to the table, actually, and put our hands on a patient, palpate, see if there's any areas of somatic dysfunction, what we say, or just dysfunction of the body in general, and then we can kind of make assessments and see if we can treat that in that manner.
Okay. And so if a patient comes in with for chronic problems or checkups, an acute problem, or even a preventive visit, so it sounds like you really offer everything an MD and allopath could, but then you have these, again, these extra skills. Dr. Garrahy, have you found any times where you've been able to perform this, and we'll talk about what this is in a few minutes, on a patient and see them get better over time?
Sure. I think when somebody comes in with an acute complaint, say a sinus infection, usually it will get better with time, but if I can provide them something in the office where they leave feeling a little bit of relief, which can only take a couple minutes of my time and their time, then I think that's just an added benefit that an osteopath can bring to the table in addition to all of the other, you know, medications and other things we would tell any patient.
Yeah, that must be very satisfying here. You're working on with someone, using your hands. They feel touched, literally and figuratively. Mm-hmm. So that must be very satisfying along those lines. When you do this in the office, how long does it take? Is it a one-time thing? Is it a series of things? Like what?
It really depends. So as far as an individual treatment session, it could range anywhere from, 2 minutes to sometimes in our OMT clinic at the Family Healthcare Center, we devote 40 minutes to an hour, depending on how many ailments the patient has and how many techniques we need to do. And it also depends on what's wrong. So one person, for example, like Dr. Garrahy mentioned, the sinus infection, we could treat that during their office visit, and that may be the only treatment they need. Whereas somebody who suffers from low back pain chronically, we may actually have them come back for repetitive sessions, until we see that they're making enough relief, and then we educate them on what to do at home, and then they can kind of continue that. So it really varies on what we're treating and how well the patient receives it.
And getting back to the holistic approach and viewpoint, when someone comes in to see an allopath like myself, I'll do what we call a history of physical. I know that osteopaths do that, but then you have a whole other layer. Can you talk a little bit about some of the other things you do when you're doing an overall assessment of a patient?
So I think the three main principles that we're taught in school is that the body is a unit, like Dr. Lewis said, but in addition we look at mind, body, and spirit as pretty much the whole package. So in addition to our history and physical, we also might do an actual osteopathic assessment where we would look, have them walk, look at their gait, look at how they're standing, their posture. So also in the physical realm of the visit as well, we're able to maybe diagnose or look at the patient and diagnose something that maybe they didn't come in for, but we might then attempt to, help or remedy at that point in time as well. So I think that's an important, like I said, tool that we have in our belt that we can kind of whip out whenever we need it, and kind of look at the patient as a whole, so from top to bottom.
So it's great, and it sounds like your training really emphasizes that. Mm-hmm. One thing, do you find, is this something that's usually covered by insurance? Because I'm sure that's could be a barrier.
Yeah, we do. We see that it's covered by most insurances. Of course, you'd have to check with your individual insurance plan, and unfortunately, some people have, high deductible plans that they would end up paying a large piece of it. But by and large, we find that it's no different than any other procedure that we would do in the office. Like if you were to have your knee injected, that it is considered a procedure, and we would bill it as such, and usually the insurance companies cover it.
Right. Well, I imagine for them, actually, it's probably cost effective, because if someone can walk out of your office feeling better, doing better, they'll save money down the road.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Makes a lot of sense regarding that. One thing that I wanted to talk about, I'm sure you get asked a lot, because we're talking about some hands-on techniques to make people feel better. There's other things in healthcare. There's physical therapists, there's chiropractors, all these. Can you talk a little bit about the nuances of that? I'm sure that there's a lot of confusion out there about that.
That is a very common question that we get. I think the biggest thing for us as osteopathic physicians is that while we are getting this hands-on manual training, it is put within the context of our medical training. So, this is, while we are going to medical school, we take the same classes as our allopathic colleagues, but we also have OMT labs where we learn the hands-on. So as we're learning the techniques, it's very much in the context of medicine and a complement to medicine. So, I find that the general philosophy between, osteopathic physicians and chiropractors are similar in that they, we're really trying to look at a dysfunction within the body and remedy it with our hands. I think the training is obviously a little different. We have slightly different techniques. We call them different things, and we might do them in a different order than a chiropractor would. Again, all within the context of medicine. And as far as physical therapy, we do a lot of patient education. So at the end of their visit, after we've actually worked on them, we spend a lot of time talking about body mechanics, posture, stretches, exercises, how to properly align the body, what they can do at home, similar to what physical therapists would do, especially when, they're giving you, the physical therapist is giving homework to do. So I think those are a lot of the similarities. I think the biggest difference is that being a trained physician, we put it all together.
Right. And in terms of an osteopath's training, it's the same exact in terms of an allopathic MD. 4 years of medical school, postgraduate training for several years in a specialty of your choice, getting boarded in that specialty. So it's the same kind of rigors along those lines.
Correct. Yeah, so. we do the same amount of time in medical school. We take the same coursework. We're doing the OMM coursework as we do those classes as well. Some osteopathic physicians actually do a fifth year of medical school, which is actually looked at more of as a fellowship in this OMM. And then we do residency. We have two of our residents here today. We take board certifications. We have to take the same step exams during medical school and residency. So pretty similar.
And is osteopathy done throughout the world, or are there certain regions of the world where it's more concentrated? Is it just a sort of an American or North American philosophy?
There's actually osteopaths in some of the European countries. Some of the philosophies are a little different. A lot of the osteopaths in the European countries, they don't actually go to medical school. They don't have as much of the medical background training. Some of the philosophies are the same. Primarily, osteopathic physicians like we are here are primarily, we're United States medical school trained. So that type of osteopathic medicine is pretty unique to the U.S. It was founded in the U.S. And all of the medical schools have grown from that philosophy and from the original medical school here. Right.
And one thing that I've learned over time is many times as osteopaths go further in their career, some of them give up doing the hands-on OMM, which I never understand, because if you have this technique and I've seen you guys help patients, why not add that? But is that something, do you find people, friends from medical school or others, are people interested in using these techniques in their careers?
So I think we're all trained the same way. We all learn the same techniques in medical school and are tested on them. As you go on in your career, I think it depends on what specialty you go into. And some physicians, I think once you start using it right out of medical school, you're more inclined to continue using it. Some find that they utilize it more than others. I think getting comfortable with it, and we do it in residency now. Just like anything, the more you use it, the more comfortable you get. I think if you don't use it for a while, it's hard to pick it back up. So learning to build it into visits now, will be more inclined to use it in the future. And I agree with you that it's a skill that I learned and spent a lot of time on, that it's not something I want to lose.
Yeah, that's smart. And if you're just joining us, we're talking tonight on Medicine in the News about osteopathy and osteopathic manipulation. My guests are Drs. Aimee Luo, Hugh Prentice, and Kelly Garrahy from the Family Medicine Osteopathic Residency Program at Reading Hospital. If you have any questions or comments, please give us a call at 610-378-0426. One thing I wanted to spend time on is I'm so pleased that you brought a table where you can demonstrate exactly what we've been talking about. Can you show some of the things that techniques that you do commonly in the office?
Yeah. Okay.
And like we said, you can do things for all types of problems, conditions, certainly musculoskeletal, but we were talking before, sinus infections, ear infections, pain, different things like that. Mm-hmm. So what are some of the common techniques or things that people could expect to see if they're seeing you in the office?
Today, we picked out a handful that we're going to show that are pretty common ones that we use. And some of these are also very simple that we train our patients to be able to do at home. So first, we're going to do what we call auricular massage, which works really well. People that have allergy problems, they tend to get a lot of fluid buildup behind their eardrums. They tend to get a lot of ear infections. So this is something that we do as part of a whole ear, nose, and throat sequence in the office. But if it's just an ear problem, you can do it alone. So Dr. Garrahy is going to demonstrate for us how you do that. So what if you can't see, what basically is happening is Dr. Garrahy is using two fingers in front of the ear and two fingers behind the ear, and then she's massaging in a circular pattern. And we usually do this for several minutes at a time, going in a clockwise and then also a counterclockwise fashion. We use this in the office as part of a whole ear, nose, and throat sequence, or you can just do this at home. And they've actually done research on this, that it can limit and decrease the number of ear infections in children, which is a great thing, because there's a lot of ongoing research and also research to back this. We, as physicians try to practice evidence-based medicine. And for a lot of these techniques, the evidence is there.
That's a great point. We should have mentioned that there's a lot of good research supporting this. So this is great. So this is something you could just do in the office during a regular office visit to help someone.
Yeah. So now we'll have, you want to do the lumbar? Okay, so now we're going to do a common lumbar technique. So lumbar is really just a term referring to the low back. So we try and segment out the back. Focusing on the lower back specifically, we're going to do what we call lumbar roll, where basically the patient lies on their side. We try and feel for the exact area of the spine where the dysfunction or the pain seems to be. We try and isolate that with our fingers while we position the lower legs. And then what we do is we kind of induce like a twisting motion using the patient's own body force as well as our hands. We stabilize the patient so that they don't feel like they're going to fall off the table. And this really induces a nice stretch in the low back. We add other components to this. You can add a thrust in this position, which sometimes will give that crack or that pop that a lot of people are familiar with OMM.
To kind of relieve pressure, sort of that tension. So this is stretching, but it's also, like you said, sort of putting things back in alignment.
Exactly.
It really, something like this, would someone come back for repeated treatments if they want, or is it a one-time thing, or?
It depends on the level of their pain. It also depends, you know, how much of this they do at home and how comfortable they are. You know, some patients, they're just so tender and so sore that they don't tolerate a lot of OMM. But for the majority of the patients, we will teach some of this, but again, in an average OMT session, this is just one of many techniques we would do in that appointment. So there usually is a need to kind of have them come back repetitively, break the cycle of that muscle spasm, and just really open up the back.
Which is, you know, low back pain, one of the most common things we see in the office, and people have tried so many things to help, so here's yet something else that can help them.
Yeah.
So what are some of the other conditions that are things you see in the office that you can do?
Pretty much anything. We have what we call contraindications, which are very specific, if you had recent surgery, if it's cancer in that area, things that we know we don't touch and we don't work over. But otherwise, there's just about, an OMT technique for just about everything. So whether it's an elbow, a shoulder, a low back, we also treat things like sinus infections, pneumonias. If you have heart failure and you have excessive fluid buildup, in your lungs, in your legs.
I guess the maneuvers could sort of help the drainage, things
exactly.
Like that is the idea. And in preparing for this, I saw some people even do these deep abdominal OMM. And how can that help with a certain abdominal pain?
We have certain abdominal techniques that people with chronic constipation, it actually helps with the nervous system in triggering the bowels, telling them to start moving. And we also work in the back, which also sends signals to the nervous system. And then there's also just direct manual techniques where we just try and move things along the bowel.
Right. So again, just very simple, common things. And people who say, oh my goodness, I'm taking medicines for this for years and years and years, I'm sick of this. There is a lot of other options. What about something as simple as sinuses? Mm-hmm. Can you demonstrate, isn't there some drainage techniques, things like that? And again, I'm just thinking viewers who are watching who have allergies or sinus infections, there's some very basic things that if they saw an osteopathic, they can get a lot of relief, very, as we say, non-invasive, not chemicals or anything like that.
Yep. So right now what Dr. Prentice is demonstrating is something that we call effleurage, which is a way of just kind of manually trying to push congestion and fluid out of the face. And then we would move on to draining it actually down the neck and massaging further down the neck, really just to get it out of the head and neck area. It might cause a lot of that congestion and discomfort. There are other techniques, where we go to like the bridge of the nose. And we kind of alternate pressure in there. You know, a lot of people naturally, when they have that kind of like sinus headache, they naturally go and pinch the bridge of their nose. This is a similar technique where we try and just offload the pressure. What Dr. Prentice is doing now is we actually look at where the nerves come out of the facial bones, and we actually try and stimulate those nerves by going in circular patterns over them. And again, it usually has a really just kind of like opening effect, can relieve some of that pressure and pain.
So like a very natural approach by triggering the nerves, you're sort of kickstarting your own body to try to help the drainage, things like that, is the idea.
Yep, that's the goal.
So, you know, we've talked a lot about some of the techniques for adults. Are there other populations that can be used? Are there techniques you can use in pregnancy, or is it completely not in, used in pregnancy?
Yeah, we can pretty much use OMT techniques in all patient populations. So including newborn, we do techniques in the pregnant patient, but we do kind of modify how they lie because they can't lie on their back for long periods of time, certainly can't lie on their stomach. So we would have them lie in what we call lateral recumbent position, which is on their side. And a lot of the same techniques we just modify. If we have patients, for example, that have a hard time transferring to a table like this, we can do in a wheelchair, we can do in a regular chair. So we can really modify it regardless of age and you know, any disability.
Right, and you had mentioned babies and pediatrics, so there's really a lot of options out there.
Yep.
I think we're just about out of time, but I guess the key would be people can just look up and call their osteopathic physicians, DOs, and ask them if they perform some of these techniques and just see them as regular doctors. A lot of DOs end up going into primary care, like family doctors like we are. It kind of makes sense given the holistic approach that you guys are trained in. So just want to thank our guests again. So tonight we've been talking about osteopathy, osteopathic manipulation, and we've had people from the Reading Hospital Family Medicine Osteopathic Residency. So again, Dr. Luo, Dr. Prentice, and Dr. Garrahy, thanks so much for coming in tonight. And I appreciate you bringing the table. And we're going to take some time to break it down for the next show. But thank you guys so much. And thanks for tuning in. Have a good evening.
Medicine in the News on BCTV is supported by Tower Health.